The province has allocated a significant amount of funding for volunteer fire departments across the province, including in Prince George and the surrounding area. Plus, the opening ceremonies were last night. The games began today. We've got the latest from the big Paranordic event. And a Prince George Cougars star player is on the comeback trail after injury. Good evening, folks. I'm Eddie Huband, and welcome to CKPG News. We begin tonight with a major funding announcement. With fire departments being overextended across BC, the province has stepped up, allocating funding to various volunteer departments, including several in Prince George and the regional district of Fraser Fort George. And it will be a major boost for the local firefighters, particularly in terms of training. Cheryl Jan brings us the story.
With this new government grant that's coming out, I think the regional district got $390,000, give or take. So I think they're dividing that up so every fire department's going to get about $30,000 for their training budget, to upgrade their training budget. So that's going to help a lot.
Lyle Wood is the fire chief for the Pineview Volunteer Fire Department, which has 23 members, a healthy fire department by many standards. It covers 80 square kilometres for fire response and over 800 kilometres for rescue response. Prince George is no stranger to firefighter training. It happens often near the airport. It's called live fire training.
So live fire training provides a facility to allow firefighters to train on structures. So something like a residential structure fire, like a house or a commercial building. It also allows them to train on vehicle fires, dumpster fires, work on propane tanks and gas meters as well. So they're all simulated props.
And that is what the province is funding through various regional districts, including the regional district of Fraser Fort George. And the job of volunteering for a fire department, of which there are well over 200 souls in the regional district, is not for the faint of heart.
When we get a new recruit, from the time they start reading the book, it's anywhere from 6 months to a year. So, and that's every Thursday night and sometimes weekends. And that's just to get your basic firefighter training in. Then you got your FR on top of that. And then we got auto extrication, we got some hazmat, we got some rope rescue. It's a pretty big commitment for anybody that wants to come join our fire department or any other volunteer fire department.
And the training standards for volunteer firefighters are the same for the likes of full-time municipal firefighters, and a shocking amount of public safety is handled by volunteers.
80% of the firefighting force in British Columbia is staffed by volunteer firefighters. And so really a large geographical area of the province, a large part of the public safety of the province is provided by volunteer firefighters. So it is an astounding number when we think about how much our community and our province will really rely on volunteer firefighters.
Melanie Perrin and Lyle Wood agrees, anytime some funding can come to training is much appreciated. Cheryl Jan, CKPG News.
To some breaking news now in provincial politics, as former BC Cabinet Minister Selena Robinson has quit the NDP, citing anti-Semitism in the ruling party's caucus. Robinson, who is Jewish, says she can no longer remain in the party because it is not properly addressing anti-Semitism in the province or among her former colleagues. She says she will now sit as an independent. She resigned her cabinet post as Minister of Post-Secondary Education last month after saying modern Israel was, quoted, was quote, founded on a crappy piece of land. The January 30th remarks sparked an outcry from pro-Palestinian groups that called them racist and Islamophobic. And we will have more on that story tomorrow as it continues to develop. Back here in Prince George, though, the opening ceremonies took place last night for the 2024 Parabiathlon World Championships. Sam Bennison has more on the big event.
There was a hum of excitement in the air as Prince George welcomed para-athletes from across the world to the Caledonia Nordic Ski Club. The Parabiathlon World Championships will not only be a showcase of athletic prowess, but for many young spectators, a moment to watch, cheer on, and learn.
I'm excited to see how, like, the people that's in wheelchairs, how they do it.
The opening ceremonies were also a chance to share with the athletes the melting pot of cultures that make up Prince George. Highlighting the evening was performances from Kim Gucci, the Method Dance Society, and the Tapestry Singers with a rendition of the national anthem in English, French, and the traditional language of Daketh. Spectators from outside Prince George were also in attendance to provide a warm Canadian welcome to the competitors.
I really enjoyed the opening ceremonies. I'm actually here visiting and happened to stumble upon the opening ceremonies and happily took it in.
Many of the spectators will be attending parabiathlon events for the first time, ready to cheer on the athletes.
I hope that you have a lot of fun here on Lake Lintonay territory, and we just hope that you enjoy Prince George.
Yeah, enjoy Northern BC while you're here, and you're gonna do great out there.
We hope you do amazing and you win all of your races and all of your competitions. You're gonna be great.
The Parabiathlon World Championships will take place all week at the Caledonia Nordic Ski Club. Closing ceremonies will be held on Sunday at the PG Conference and Civic Center. They will be followed up by the Paranordic World Cup Finals set to begin on Tuesday, March 12th. Sam Bennison, CKPG News.
So obviously the Caledonia Nordic Ski Club is the hub of activity with the Parabiathlon World Championships and Paranordic World Cup Finals, but all that activity has been impacting our community as well as a whole in a big way. Tommy Osborne has more on the economic boost from the big events.
Prince George has been buzzing with activity, not only from the Parabiathlon World Championships and Paranordic World Cup Finals, but also the annual meeting of the Federation of Canadian Municipalities, bringing thousands of municipalities to our community.
Usually coming out of Christmas, January, February are typically slower times for us in the hotel industry, so this event has been something that we've all been looking forward to. Definitely seeing much higher occupancy, a lot more guests and people from all over the world coming to stay with us.
In the restaurant world, Owen Foley, owner of several restaurants, estimates it's at least a 20% bump from what he usually sees.
A slower Tuesday night, where we might be, more than half full, it might make us completely full that night. Often during the weekdays, it's just kind of covering costs and making sure that we're keeping people employed and still here, and if we make all those slower days profitable nights, then it makes a huge difference.
When business is booming, it's not just the owners and management that benefit. It helps everyone on all levels and brings benefits to the entire community.
We've got over 35 people employed in our hotel, full-time and part-time, and the fuller we are, the busier everybody else is. Everybody stays working. More people in the hotel means that all areas are busy, lots more wear and tear, we've got lots of cleaning to do, and I mean we are a 24/7 operation, so definitely need to keep people employed all day, all night in a hotel like this.
The staff are happier to be busy, they want to be busier, they make more in this business, they make more money when we are busier.
The expected total revenue to our local businesses should be in the millions of dollars. And these events are going for several weeks, which means our local business owners should be expecting quite a big bump in their revenue over the next 2 weeks, meaning not only does our local business community thrive, but our entire community in general. Tommy Osborne, CKPG News.
Canfor has released its fourth quarter numbers, and it's showing a loss of more than $500 million over the last year in total. The fourth quarter numbers are painting a particularly bleak picture. Cheryl Jan joins us now to discuss this. So, Cheryl, let's talk big picture. What's going on right now with Canfor?
Well, I mean, fourth quarter losses alone are $191 million. Let's just say that. And the company is citing persistent challenges in British Columbia, namely the ongoing challenges with the availability of, and this is the key here, economically viable fiber, which is impacting both the lumber side and the pulp side of operations. And we are intimately aware of this because we've seen the closure of curtailments of Polar Sawmill in Bear Lake, permanent closure of Plateau in Vanderhoof, as well as PG Saw, PG Pulp, pardon me, and Alpierre. So there's been lots of repercussions locally because of this.
Yeah, and so can you dive deeper into the issue here? It's basically about the price of lumber.
Kind of, yeah. I mean, they've been citing the lack of access to fiber supply, for fiber supply being wood, trees, for quite some time. But to make a break, to make a buck for a lumber company, they have to hit at least 300 and change per 1,000 board feet. Mm-hmm. Right now, lumber prices, as you saw on that graph, have plummeted recently, and they're up now just around the $400 per 1,000 board feet mark, which is not what you call a very healthy number.
Now, what's the outlook moving forward? I know that there's talks that there could be some big changes coming to Canfor operations. Can you speak to that?
Well, the outlook, I mean, they have been expanding their operations into the southern U.S. for quite some time, as well as Sweden. I mean, they bought mills in Mississippi, Hammerville, Mississippi, also Alabama, and as well as, like I said, Sweden, South Carolina. So they're expanding their operations south, which they say is actually a much better place to be.
Interesting stuff. All right, and we're going to have more on this developing story later on this week with a full story. Cheryl, thank you very much for your insight.
You're very welcome.
And in other news, a new foundry center is opening in Vanderhoof to serve several communities across the region. Foundry centers across BC service sites for health, mental wellness, as well as substance use services for youth. Carrier Sakani Family Services is pleased to announce that we'll be leading the development of a foundry center to serve families and youth in Vanderhoof.
Yeah, so on March 3rd, the province announced the expansion of the foundry centers. Vanderhoof was one of the successful sites that is coming. A foundry is a one-stop shop for youth, all youth, ages 12 to 24. Some of the services they will offer is primary care, mental health, peer support, substance use, and outreach. So in Vanderhoof and in these rural communities, we're really finding services are lacking, but the problems are still occurring. Youth are currently rather not seeking services at all or going to the hospital, and the hospitals in these rural communities are not equipped to work with mental health issues, primary care, or there's long wait times that youth are just not patient for. So having a center in these small communities is great because there's no wait times, it's all drop-in, and it's for all youth ages 12 to 24.
As of this morning, the lowest gas price in Prince George was sitting at $1.529 a litre at Costco. That also happens to be the lowest price in the province right now. Manitoba currently has the lowest fuel prices on average in the country at $1.33 per litre, while BC has an average price of $1.778 per litre.
CKPG Sports is delivered by Domino's. Feed your team tonight with a delicious mix-and-match combo. Chicken, pizza, pasta, or dessert for just $8.99 per item.
The Prince George Cougars shared some big news yesterday, posting a video to social media that showed a star forward, Cohen Zeemer, back in Prince George with the team. Exciting. Anthony Correa got a chance to catch up with the star forward after his first practice with the Cats since last year.
An exciting sight for Cougars fans. Cohen Zeemer skating in the CN Center with his teammates.
Yeah, obviously it's been a couple tough months here in the last, since November there, but it's good to be back finally and just being around the guys. Being away from that long is pretty tough, so just to be back and be on the ice again is a good feeling.
It's the first time number 13 has skated with the team since his gruesome lower body injury back in late November against the Everett Silvertips. First on the agenda for the forward is to get back up to speed and getting back into a routine.
Yeah, my conditioning is obviously going to be pretty bad for the next couple weeks here, but just put me through a little bag skate there, so yeah, I'll have a couple more of those in the next couple weeks.
With the Cougars in no rush to get Zeemer back into the lineup, taking the recovery process one day at a time.
Everyone's talking 2 to 4 weeks, we'll see where it is, and you know, it's up to Zeem to decide how hard he pushes himself to get back in the lineup, but you know, we put ourselves as a group in a good situation where it's not immediate. Maybe if we were chasing for a spot, he'd be probably pushed a little bit harder to get in there. We definitely want to take our time and make sure that he's 100% for when he gets back in.
But for his teammates, it's just good to see him back in the locker room, joking around and getting accustomed once again.
Yeah, it was sweet, obviously, to see him back on the ice, and you know, he looked great and green in my eyes, and yeah, it's just exciting to see him try to get his feet back under him. He'll be working hard and with our staff and stuff, and they'll do a good job. If it was my choice, he'd be back in the lineup right away, but obviously, you know, you got to heal up that ankle, and yeah, no, he's looking really good.
He's a great guy, you know, he's a great teammate, and you know, everybody loves him in that room, and it's obviously awesome to see him here. You know, it's been a while, and yeah, we're really excited to get him back on the ice and skating, and hopefully he can get in with us before the end of the regular season. But yeah, it's going to be a big boost for us.
Obviously, surgery went well there, and rehab went well as well. But yeah, everything's been healing how it's supposed to. The doctors said everything looks good here.
Anthony Correa, CKPG News.
Mr. Correa joins us in studio now. Anthony, exciting times. I'm fired up tonight.
Oh, so am I.
Yeah,
man. It's exciting.
Cohen Ziemer back in the lineup. What can fans expect to see adding to this already pretty potent offense?
Well, they can't expect anything soon right now. You know, the coaches kind of made it very clear they're going to slow play this, which is a very smart decision with the Cougars in second place or first place in the West. You know, fighting for that top spot, but still top two seed. You know, maybe not this weekend against Vancouver. I think possibly next weekend he'll join them on the road trip. You know, they go down to Kelowna, Victoria twice, and then that final road trip game in Vancouver. Maybe you could see him suit up, and then they have a home and home in Kamloops. So Cougars fans might be able to see him at least once this season, season finale, and, you know, that's the fingers crossed. Hopefully everything goes according to plan, and, yeah, there's some high hopes for Cohen Ziemer returning to the ice at least.
Now, what's this, is there lineup specific here? What's this team going to look like? Where's he going to fit? And obviously he's going to be probably in that top line. No?
Yes, top line. You know, it's going to be interesting what Mark Lamb does, because last year he had Chase Wheatcroft, the 20-year-old, with Cohen Ziemer and Riley Height. Now Zach Funk is the 20-year-old this year, and he is doing exceptionally well, you know, Cougars single season goal record. But personally, for me, I think that they are actually going to keep Borjavallis on that top line. He's been showing incredible chemistry with Riley Height, and adding Cohen Ziemer, a pure scorer, to those two playmakers, I think would be electric, and it gives Mark Lamb opportunities elsewhere around the lineup. You know, maybe having Funk on the second line with Parisak and Becker, a line that they started the year, had incredible stuff. And the thing that shocks me is Carlin DeZane on the third line, is, you know, a guy who's been incredible.
Adding depth, right?
Exactly. Yeah. And, you know, he's clicked with Oren Strome. He's been a third line year, all year. So, you know, depth up and down the forward lineup for the Prince George Cougars.
It's going to be fun come playoff time with Mr. Ziemer coming back. And how did he look? You got to see him in action.
You know,
a little tired?
Yeah, a little out of breath, you know. Carter Rigby had him doing some bag skates back and forth, you know, on one knee, sipping the water down. It looked like he was having a little.
Little guy has to be expected, though.
Exactly.
You know what we got to do, Anthony? We got to send him to the Y with our news director, Mr. Greg Fry.
And get some weights going, right?
Get him on the treadmill over there. And
It will come within time, you know, obviously the conditioning there. But, you know, I'm sure he's excited to be back in the locker room working out. And the trainers have some schedules for him to go back and forth there.
Greg Fry is a robot, by the way, folks. If you're at the Y working out, that man is on the treadmill every night, rain
bang,
or shine.
Bang, bang,
snow.
Bang, bang.
Yeah, we'll send Zeems over to get a nice workout with the Fry guy. Get him back in shape.
I don't know. I think Ziemer might have Greg edged on that one.
So. Maybe a little bit. I don't know.
One's drafted to an NHL team. Hey, the other one, you know.
Listen, I've seen him going on that treadmill. He can burn it.
I believe you, honestly. And so we'll see how that goes. But, you know, conditioning for both guys at an all-time high.
CKP3, what do we got tonight?
You know, we got the Oilers. We got the Canucks, both with some incredible games last night and both happy with the results in tonight's CKP3.
We start with the Oilers using their stars.
Then back to Connor McDavid, Edmonton seeking victory. McDavid around McAvoy, dishes off one timer. Star Leon Draisaitl, and Edmonton gets the equalizer late, and Draisaitl wins the game. 2-1 in overtime.
Edmonton wouldn't have it any other way. Connor McDavid to Leon Draisaitl, like bread and butter. Edmonton wins the game 2-1 in overtime. Next, it's to LA, where a robbery takes place.
And it's out to center, 2-on-1. Kopitar with Turcotte. Kopitar, Turcotte. Oh, Turcotte! Are you kidding me? With the glove moving to his left, and he keeps it a tie game.
The Canucks and Kings dead even in the third period, and Thatcher Demko makes his mark on the game, throwing up the glove to rob LA's Alex Turcotte to keep the score at one apiece. Finally, Vancouver back on track.
Hughes. JT Miller down to Besser. Miller scores! There's overtime goal number 9 as a member of the Canucks. JT Miller. 96 seconds into overtime. He ties Brendan Morrison for second in all-time overtime goals with Vancouver. And the Canucks win it in overtime in Los Angeles, 2-1.
This could very well be a playoff series we see between these two teams. But let's look at that slapper by JT Miller. A bullet to give the Canucks a big 2 points in overtime as OT Heroics take top spot in tonight's CKP3.
The TSX is up 68 points to close at 21,594. The Dow Jones is up 76 points to close at 38,661. Canfor, meanwhile, went up 37 cents to close at $17.02.
Good evening. We are in for some flurries tonight and tomorrow, and then we could see things picking up into periods of snow for tomorrow evening. The best part of this weather forecast going forward is actually going to be the really mild temperatures on the way. I'm just going to jump right into the future cast so we can see that. And here it is, the first system. So hitting the north coast up towards Haida Gwaii, bringing lots of rain, and then inland north coast, more so the flurries or even some snow. And so for us, it's the unsettled conditions tonight and tomorrow. But as that system picks up into our later part of Thursday, and you'll see here we do have the potential for a lot of those flurries to switch over to periods of snow. So don't be alarmed if we see periods of snow going into tomorrow evening, but after that we should clear out at least for Friday. We'll kind of be in between systems on Friday. 2 degrees Fort St. John tomorrow. We're looking at much milder air starting to trickle in and pushing up from the south, of course, but really it's Friday and the weekend that we'll really notice a transition. But we'll welcome plus one for our daytime tomorrow. And again, flurries in the mix though. 5 degrees for Kamloops, milder down through the south coast, in through the Okanagan as well. And pretty much everywhere going to be seeing much milder air taking over. And it's just in time for the weekend, just in time for the time change, of course, as we spring forward. Minus one for Mackenzie and Fort St. James as well. Seeing lots of unsettled conditions the next couple of days though. Over towards Burns Lake, you're sitting just above freezing, but expecting some light snow in the forecast. And again, as mentioned, our flurries could switch over to periods of snow going into our night tomorrow night. Quick snapshot of the country for you. It's pretty nice along the western half, at least for the most part. Some areas still under, at least on the west coast, under a ridge of high pressure still, but looking at some cooler air in through the prairies for the day tomorrow, minus 11 in Regina, minus 8 Winnipeg, and then temperatures are still nice and mild in through Montreal, Toronto, over towards the Maritimes, though a little bit more unsettled. So chance of showers is also possible for our weekend, and because we are seeing these milder temperatures, that is why. So as the freezing level rises, some of that precipitation can certainly switch over to either a wintry mix or even just straight showers. 5 to 10 though tonight in Burns Lake, so a real wintry kind of feeling for you, minus 15, but 6 degrees by Friday, even though you're still seeing some snow, minus 14 overnight tonight in Mackenzie and up to minus 1 tomorrow. But this is the transition day here. Friday and Saturday is when we really start to see a much milder trend, although cloudy and pretty unsettled with precipitation. It'll be quite a wet one in McBride Friday, Saturday, Sunday, but mild temperatures, certainly not as cold as it has been tonight, though down to minus 16. Quesnel, partly cloudy and cold tonight, lots of cloud cover tomorrow, and then you're up to 6 degrees Friday and Saturday, and there are the showers that you could see. So for us, it is going to be pretty wintry tonight and tomorrow and right through to tomorrow night. Friday, we get a break, maybe even a sunny break in there as well, highs of 6, if you can believe it, and then 7 degrees on Saturday, rain a drizzle in the morning especially. Sunday is our best chance to return once again to some nice sunny skies, but that milder air really taking over beginning Friday and carrying at least at this point right through to next week. Don't forget, we're springing forward this weekend as mentioned, and you turn your clocks forward and hopefully that will signal some springtime.
CKPG Sports is delivered by Domino's. Feed your team tonight with a delicious mix and match combo. Chicken, pizza, pasta, or dessert for just $8.99 per item.
Following a historic year for the UNBC T-Wolves men's basketball team, the team just announced a new addition to bolster its roster. 6'2 combo guard Marcus Wilson from New Brunswick was one of the top high school prospects from Eastern Canada. He'll be joining a roster fresh off that bronze medal finish in the Canada West playoffs. Like his favorite NBA players Paul George and LaMelo Ball, Wilson does his damage on all three levels and added he likes facilitating for his teammates as well. T-Wolves head coach Todd Jordan says he's very excited for Wilson to join the team, saying he has tremendous upside and has been a high-level scorer throughout his high school career. As for Wilson himself, well, he can't wait to touch court next season.
I really like the fit of the program for me and how the players have a great chemistry together and stuff like that, but I feel like more of the fit. The guys are great, you know, great bond, great team chemistry, and looking forward to it. The campus, great gym, like the facility. You know, it seems like a great campus to get education, lots of help for academics and stuff like that. Yeah, I like it.
Volunteers are crucial for almost any event, and the Parabiathlon World Championships aren't any different. Caitlin Pobersnick has the story on this year's volunteer group for the games and what it entails to be working down at the ski club.
There isn't an inch of Caledonia Nordic Ski Club that isn't covered with people. What makes up most of them, other than the athletes, is volunteers. Sign up for volunteer positions were open for months prior to the Parabiathlon and Paranordic finals, and now that they're here, there are over 300 volunteers ready to go, and it's still growing.
So we thought we would get by with about 300, but we found that some people could only volunteer on the weekends. Some people could only volunteer for 1 or 2 days. So our numbers are upwards of 350, 360, 370. I haven't taken a final count, but each day we're doing up new accreditation because some area was short one person on one day or two people. So we're filling those.
Out of the volunteers working at the games, a large population of them are Ukrainian immigrants that have called Prince George their home.
Well, in 2022, I had a couple. I had Annabelle and her niece who had come in from the Ukraine. They volunteered in 2022. She reached out to me and said, we have people that want to volunteer. She works for Hope Saves, or she volunteers there. And they came out. Some of them had only been in Canada for a week. We did a literal introduction. A lot of it was charades because they don't all speak English. And now we have so many of them coming back, and they are in so many different areas throughout the course here.
Vonda says the atmosphere at the ski club is what makes coming back so easy for her and other volunteers. And the time and effort that is put in by everyone involved is infectious.
Our crews are amazing. Set up and range set up. They're here at 6 o'clock in the morning, and they're out here setting up. So yesterday, my volunteer crew in the volunteer tent showed up. Our heat froze overnight, so it was 26 outside and 26 inside. And they worked. We have to be there for the other volunteers. But this is what we do in the north, where we just adapt. We come in, we get warm, we go back out, we do our job.
Many of the athletes have vocalized their appreciation to have so much support from the community in Prince George so that they can continue to have opportunities just like this one. Caitlin Pobersnick, CKPG News.
Oh, hello there. Yeah, not in the CKPG Today side of the studio. Today we're at Imogen White, and yes, they even got me to say yes to the dress, and you've got quite the segment coming for you today, including some entertainment. This is already, if this isn't enough for you, we have more. Plus, we're going to describe the current trends and current colors of this year's prom and grad shopping session that you probably, if you're a parent, you're all too familiar with already. All right, how about you over there? You ever done something or wanted to do something your whole life, never done it? I'm going to do something for you right now. Ready? Ta-da!
Oh my goodness, Caden Fancha, the belle of the ball. Wow, so many jokes are coming to my head right now, but this is a family show, so, you know. But I will say this, that dress definitely brings out your eyes, Caden. Love the look there on that one. that's our show tonight, folks. Your last look this evening is an awesome one. It's a moose having a bedtime snack at the North Nechako Road Evergreen Trailer Park. Here she is. Big thanks to Joanne Maloney for sending this in to us. Awesome video. Thank you very much, Joanne. And that wraps up our show. Thanks very much for joining us, folks. And if you have nightmares from seeing Caden in a dress tonight, I'm truly sorry. Have a great night. We'll see you tomorrow.